Some more detailed information on what might they propose for a special session and economic packages, and from the DNR some more specific information on the direction that they want to go long term. So with that, who would like to start with their presentation? Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good morning, everyone. Katie Clark Sieben from DEED. I think where I'd like to begin is, in your packet you have a map of Mille Lacs area businesses. If you could pull that handout out. So as we very seriously took the recommendation from our last working meeting to put something on paper in an effort to try to move this forward, to try to quickly respond to businesses in the area that are very concerned about the future of their businesses, we wanted to start by asking this group some questions. We've provided very detailed questions of the group, and if we can get some answers to those questions ideally today, we'd be happy to go back and draft language right away if that's the direction that this group heads in. But what I'd like to start with is a map of the Mille Lacs area. I've mentioned at past working group meetings that we took roughly a 15-mile radius from the center of Mille Lacs Lake to understand what tourism-related businesses could be impacted, how many businesses are we talking about in the area, knowing that if we put language together, we wouldn't be able to say a business roughly 15 miles from the center of the lake. That might be kind of a hard measurement for our business owners to figure out. We're suggesting that defining townships and a few cities in language would be the best approach. So we've put together an option for the working group to consider of what townships and cities would be included, and that's what's shown here on the map with the blue outline. Included in that area is 161 total businesses, and you can see the breakdown underneath the map. That's 46 lodging businesses, 33 restaurants, 31 amusement recreation, 17 food beverage, 11 retails, 10 sporting goods, and 6 personal care, and then 7 other, which in the footnotes are 3 gas stations, 3 general merchandise, 1 movie, and 1 non-store retail. So it gives you a pretty detailed information on what all is in that area related to tourism, what businesses may be experiencing an impact. We would, of course, look to all of you in the working group to help us define, should all of those businesses be included, or is this financial package geared towards a certain group, certain industries within this group that we want to try to support during this economic downturn in the area. So that hopefully provides some context to the list of questions that I'd now like to go through and who we're talking about. These are the businesses that when I visited a few weeks ago were saying, we don't know how we're going to pay our utility bill. We don't know how we're going to pay salaries for employees as a result of this situation, and we need assistance. So we are still proposing that 0% interest loan as an option, but working towards what that loan could or should look like, we have a series of questions for the group to provide some information on. So if I can point your attention now towards this two-page memo, and I'll provide some more information and then open it up, Mr. Chair, for however you'd like to organize the discussion today, but I'll walk through it to start. Does that sound good?
I'm a little bit confused by it.
Okay.
You have questions for us as a working group?
I do.
Is that what we asked you to bring forward? I mean, we thought you guys were going to put the package together, and we were asking you for this kind of information about what the governor's office was proposing. That was my question from the beginning.
Yep.
When the governor, what is it now, maybe a month ago, said, hey, I want to have a special session, and I want to do an economic package to help these folks out around the Mille Lacs Lake.
Mm-hmm.
We thought maybe he had something in mind.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently he didn't, and we've been asking now. This is our third meeting, and I still don't see a proposal. I mean, you have questions for us. We're looking for answers from you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chair, respectfully, so the governor has from the very beginning put forth that he believes 0% interest loans are of need to businesses in the area, that we should be providing that economic assistance to businesses in the area. And he's charged all of us with figuring out what could or should that look like. My questions today and at the past working groups, I've presented what Deed thinks may be the right approach, but it will take all of us working together to come to that right solution. So as we go through these questions, I think you'll see these are very detailed questions. We are still proposing that 0% interest loan up to $100,000 per loan per business. This is a series of very detailed questions to help us be able to draft language as a next step. So as we walk through the questions, I think it'll become more clear why we have a list of questions in front of you today. So for example, some of the things that we would need a little bit more feedback on, do you want to specify that applicants must be a business that's directly or indirectly affected by the decline of walleye fishing in Lakes Mille Lacs? So directly could be a resort, indirect might be retailer or restaurant as
well,
one
Commissioner,
example.
I thought that maybe the department and the governor had an idea of what they wanted to do.
The governor has said that he wants to provide economic assistance to businesses. He has put forth the idea of a 0% interest loan to businesses. In order for the department to draft language, he's charged all of us, this working group.
All of us
with
is,
coming
no,
up
not
with
the
that
working
solution.
Group, not the working group, your department and you, Commissioner.
I believe he's charged this working group with coming
well,
to a
well,
solution.
Well, I don't think that the governor has a lot of control over the working group.
Well, Mr. Chair, I'm happy to present what we've prepared for today, and we'd be
That's
happy to
go ahead.
Draft language based on any sort of feedback that we received today.
We were asking for what the governor is proposing. That's what we've been asking. This is the third working group. What is the governor proposing? What are the details of what the governor is proposing? And that's what we wanted to look at.
Yep. And Mr. Chair, I don't want to beat a dead horse here, but the governor has proposed a 0% interest loan up to $100,000. These are very
specific
questions.
And we wanted to know how all those things, and the questions that you're proposing to us are the things that we wanted to know from you. What are those things? How is all of that going to work? That's what we thought we were going to hear today, is how are those low interest loans or no interest loans going to work? We thought you were putting that together.
We do have that put together. And
okay.
Mr. Chair,
I thought that was going to be the presentation today.
Well, if you'll let me go through the questions, it may become more clear.
So at the end, you're going to have the proposal.
If we can have a little bit of feedback from members sitting around the table, we can easily put this together. Can I proceed?
Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Some of the other pieces that we would need answered in order to draft that language for this 0% interest loan, would you like nonprofits to be eligible for the program? There is a museum in the area as one example, so we would need to decide whether or not that should be included, which industries should be eligible. The geographic area, we've put forth what we think that geographic area should look like, but wanted to confirm with the group that that's the area that you would like to see receive economic assistance. Number six, we would suggest having loans flow through local lenders, specifically the regional development commissions and the initiative foundations. And we would recommend for the purposes of making sure that we can quickly get these loans out to businesses, actually listing initiative foundations and RDCs in the legislative language, so that solely for the purpose so we can move quickly. And to clarify, that would mean we wouldn't need to do an RFP process to have lenders respond to that. We could just directly get moving with RDCs and initiative foundations. And we have contacted the local RDCs and initiative foundations, and they are ready to provide assistance should a package move forward. Would you like to require applicants to present evidence of how the walleye decline has affected revenue? One option, and what we've seen, what we've done with past programs, is to require businesses to demonstrate a revenue decline in any two-year period since 2010. These are all recommendations based on making sure that we have strong accountability for this loan program, and that we have clarity for the local lenders that would be reviewing these applications so they know exactly how they should be moving forward in distributing these funds to businesses. Would you like to require applicants to be organized as a proprietorship, partnership, LLC, or corporation? This is just giving the local lenders, giving deed clarity that, yes, this is an established business. It's not just a business that maybe is registered with the Secretary of State, but it is a business that's currently in operation and established. Let's see. Do you want to require applicants that have been in operation and owned by the same owners for a certain period of time during the revenue decline? And this can get a little bit confusing, but clarity can help those local lenders to move more quickly. But this points towards, if a business had a new owner, how do we determine that decline in business revenue is a result of the walleye issue and not bad management? as just one example. And so would you like us to put something in language around that piece? And then as far as eligible and ineligible activities, we would recommend the language includes specifically what these loans could be used for and what they cannot be used for. So what we're recommending is that eligible use for loan funds could be for repair of buildings, leasehold improvements, fixtures or equipment, inventory, and working capital. And we've heard from businesses that working capital piece is the most important piece to make sure that the loans could be used for. Ineligible activities could be lending or investment operations, land speculation, relocation, management fees, financing costs, debt consolidation, moving costs, refinancing debt, startup costs, and business or property acquisition. And these definitions of what would be eligible or ineligible are based on past history of how we would approach a disaster situation and what businesses would be eligible to use loans for or not eligible to use in that situation. So it's just being consistent. Do you want to require applicants be in compliance with all local, state, and federal laws and not be subject to any judgment, liens, or actions? This is how all of our economic development programs are structured, is that we do that check to make sure that before the state would be loaning these businesses any additional monies, that they are made whole already with the state and do not have any existing debt with the state or any issues with the state. Do you want to require applicants to submit a business plan? We wouldn't require a, 30-page document business plan. It could be as simple as a few paragraphs. We want to make this process easy for businesses as well to apply. But we would recommend that we ask them to submit a business plan. Again, just doing some due diligence, making sure they are in operation, that they have a plan, that this walleye situation is truly the reason for a decline in revenue. How lenient should the underwriting and security requirements be? This is basically just giving us information on how you would like us to review these applications and the local lenders on how they should be reviewing these applications. And then, let's see. Do you want allocations to be granted based on the lender's evaluation of a complete application, including a determination of the probable success of the business plan and repayment of the loan? So again, just giving us direction and local lenders on exactly how we should be thinking and reviewing that application. And then the second page, so loan limitations. You know, one question is, do you want to make sure that a business can only receive one loan, or could they be eligible to apply for a second at some point in the process? We are recommending the loan maximum be amount of $100,000, based on what we've done for past programs. Duration of the loan, we're recommending 10 years, again, based on history of what we've done for other programs. We're recommending a 0% interest loan, as we have from the beginning. Structuring repayments of the loans, we had discussed at the last working meeting, deferring the first 2 years. It could be, you know, potentially deferring the first 2 to 3 years, depending upon what timing we think, what sort of impact this will have on the local community. But we think that's appropriate to have a deferral of repayment to help the recovery of these businesses. And then some of you have brought forth the idea of forgiveness. We would just need clarity on when should we be forgiving a loan. One recommendation that we have is that if you went down the path of forgiveness, that it might be if a business is still in operation after that 10-year mark, then that half of the loan would be forgiven. But again, that would be, we would need further clarity on what the group is thinking there. And then we would need to establish some administrative costs to pay for both deed staff time and the local lender staff time in what they will be doing with processing those loans, monitoring, ongoing monitoring of those loans. We'll be checking in on probably a twice a year process with these businesses to see where they're at. And then would just need to know what type of reporting the legislature would like to receive on these loans. We would recommend a semi-annual basis until December 31st of 2016. So you get more regular updates, but then we could do an annual report after that time period. And then for the application period, we'd recommend that business loan agreements be executed by November 30th of 2016, but allow funds to be available through the end of 2016 to account for any ongoing potential losses, anything that could happen over the winter season. That would give businesses an extended period to be able to apply if they're not currently seeing revenue declines, but that happens 6 months from now, that resource would still be available to them. I hope that helps explain. We are definitely putting forth a recommendation of moving forward and moving forward quickly to provide support to the businesses in the area of up to $100,000 loans, 0% interest, deferring that first 2 years of payment. We just need a little bit of detail in order to be able to come back to this group with specific language. We are recommending this be a standalone program. And with answers to these questions, we can easily come back with language. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Questions, members? Ms. McCoy, do you have a question? Comment?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members. Tina and I had a chance to look at these questions and speak with a lot of the people back in our area, and we did have a couple of comments if you wanted them, or we could provide them at a later time.
Okay, we'll look at them a little later. I think Representative Lewick.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I had a quick question on, I guess it was item 11.
Yeah.
Debt consolidation, refinancing debt as a possibility of not allowing that. I guess it strikes me that for those things that are not personal debt, but things that relate to the business, the ability to restructure debt is pretty fundamental to trying to change the shape of your future balance sheet and your survival. So right off the bat, it would strike me that any loan program should allow for that, provided it's for specific to the business. You know, if you bought a new snowmobile last year for your own personal use, that's your problem. But business-related, otherwise, I think that would be a big handcuff. The other one right after that is submit a business plan. Yes, obviously, anybody that's going to loan money needs to know exactly what you're going to use the money for. But for continued operation until the walleye fishing season resources recovers, at this point, you know, we'll have to wait to see what our folks from the DNR says. But we don't really have a solid answer for that at this point. So I'm not sure that we can answer that question. We could use that description, but there's no hard end date on it. I think all of us realize that. Mm-hmm. Let me look at a couple other questions. I guess, and I've been involved in discussions literally every day since last week on this, that $100,000 cap or $100,000 is, you know, there's been some discussion amongst at least some of the businesses up on the north end of the lake and some on the south end too about if there was going to be a program looking at $200,000, but that would be total loans, and the importance of being able to, without knowing what's going to happen over the exactly what's going to happen over the next year or two, have a cap, but be able to make a second application if things markedly change, that any loan program would need that flexibility for in this circumstance, because we can't predict where we're going to be exactly a year from now. And I see trying to, you know, I hope and pray we're going to be out of this situation clearly 10 years from now, but you know, what I'm hearing from the GUT resort folks as of just yesterday and the day before is we borrow money, we expect to pay it back. However, looking at this thing on a 10-year basis, we get out to that point, let's say we start paying on that loan 2 years from now, we pay on it through 8 years. It would seem that being able to either forgive or cut in half what was left at the 10-year point wouldn't be unreasonable, I guess. And then the final question I have, that's just my thoughts after consulting with folks for almost daily for a week. You vision putting together a set of a statutory piece here that would allow you to do this. Could you do this today without under the current statutes? I mean, I assume you can't, but I'd like to hear that a point blank again. Mm-hmm. Could you do this without us having to go to special session?
Mm-hmm. Commissioner Sieben.
Mr. Chair, we would not be able to do this without a special session. We do not have the authority to move money from one program to another. That requires legislative approval. And we do not have any funding to put towards this specific activity.
Mr. President Lewick.
Those are my thoughts. I think some type of loan program, and this is a good start. The other part of it is timeliness. Can you give us an idea if somebody shows up 2 weeks from now with a loan application, just generally, how long will it be before you've went through the process?
Mm-hmm. Commissioner?
Mr. Chair. Yes, we've talked with local lenders to get a sense of what their current workload is, and should a special session happen, should this move forward, how quickly can they assist businesses? And we estimate that we can assist between 25 to 35 businesses per week. So with the 161 total in the area, if we did that full group, probably about a month and a half, we'd be able to serve the full group.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, thank you, Ms. Chair. That at least answers a couple of questions.
Representative Erickson was next.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Commissioner, for your presentation. You have raised some very, very valid questions. But I see this as a short-term fix, and what this area, and I've put at your places an open page from the fund guide that's distributed around Lake Mille Lacs area is a long-term fix for economic growth. We need a level playing field in this area. And so these folks, whether they're in business today or new who may come, we need to look at an enterprise zone. And so I would hope that you would begin with Commissioner of Revenue to design one, because I'm working on one for next session. But I would like to see how yours would compare to the idea that I have that I will share with Senator Brown, Senator Kerry Rood, and with Representative Lewick, because we need economic growth here. And this will take care of what's been happening for the last 18 years. But this will not this will not help for the sustaining of this area for the next 20 years. And that's what we have to look at. Because people love to live in this area, but they need jobs, and they need an income that's going to support their families. Our school districts have to know that they're not going to have today 300 children and tomorrow 250, or you know, some number around that. These are small school districts, and Isle is actually closer to 500, but that and Onamia as well. But and then we go north, but. You know, we have to give them a sense of security. So what can we do to ensure that we have economic growth and that we're competitive with the casino operation on the west side? Because there's no way that they can compete, you know, with the packages that Joe through Corporate Ventures can offer. So, you know, what can we do to ensure that they who focus on the lake and families can continue? So please give some thought to that.
Ms. Chapman?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I agree with Sandra that the loan program is a short-term fix, but I do have some comments on your mm-hmm. questions. For number one, should businesses be directly or indirectly? We felt they both.
Ms. Chapman, are you going to go through all 24 questions?
I have a few notes. I mean, unless everybody wants to pick and choose and out of order, I'm ready to go right in order with some quick responses to our opinions to it.
Well, I have a definite opinion on the questions overall anyway, so, okay. But go ahead.
I can make it as quickly as I can.
Thank you.
What size businesses should be eligible? We suggest not limiting the size of businesses, allow the businesses to self-select if they choose to use the loan assistance program or not. As far as nonprofits, we would suggest not. Some of the industries we suggested that might be removed are the museums and historical sites, health. We still felt personal care was necessary, membership organizations, business and professional, and the non-store retailer. We weren't exactly sure what that was comprised of. The geographic areas, we concurred with that. The loan flow through the local lenders. We would like you to consider maybe using the for-profit banks. They've been working with the local businesses. They're aware of their situations. We have talked to one of the local lenders, and they said they could work with you. They would need some compensation in that, mm-hmm. and which is alluded to later. Mm-hmm. And we feel they could probably handle it quicker than the Initiative Foundation. And we suggested that if you're going to use the Regional Development and the Initiative Foundations, use those if the local mm-hmm. for-profit banks can't be used. Requiring that the applicants to present evidence, yes. There may be a minimal percentage of decline, but we ask you to keep in mind that as some businesses have diversified away from walleye, they may show additional revenue, but additional expenses but still have additional expenses. An example is if they built spear houses last winter when the northern spearing was allowed by the DNR. So their decline in income may not look right on paper. Mm-hmm. As far as organizing proprietorship, partnership, we felt that should be all categories because all the businesses are organized differently. Some are, you know, sole proprietor, others are corporations. As far as certain periods, being in operation, you know, probably as to what that would be, we don't have a definite answer for that. Who is eligible, or what is eligible? We added in repair of buildings and property, like parking lots, dock systems. We moved the financing costs, refinancing debt, and expansion of existing businesses up to the allowable. We took out the financing costs, refinancing the debt, business or property acquisition out of the ineligible. As far as the requirement to be in compliance, we felt that being in compliance with the applicable local, state, and federal laws might raise some questions. For example, if, let's just say, a restaurant is having an issue because they've been cited for maybe their salad bar doesn't meet the specifications, should that negate them from being eligible? We felt it did not, so we took that particular sentence out. We left the rest alone. Submitting a business plan, we were in agreement, you know, that some type of justification is necessary, but it needed to remain simple to keep it streamlined. For how the underwriting, we said one set of rules for consistency if you're using different lenders. How should the applications be considered? We agreed, but can there be a limited time or a time limit placed for turnaround to keep the process moving toward relief so that there's not that, you know, big delay? Allocations to be granted based on lender's evaluation. We said, given this situation, it would be very easy to demonstrate that the business doesn't show probable success, and that would defeat the purpose of the program. Instead, we suggest that allocations be made only where there is sufficient equity remaining in business to allow centralized or collateralization of the loan. As setting limitations, we also were in concurrence with Representative Lewick as to the $200,000. We felt, you know, one time, two time, maybe being able to come back, but a total of $200,000. We agreed with the 10 years following the first payment. Zero interest, we agree. Restructure of the repayment. We suggested a deferral of 3 years to coincide with the DNR's expectation for when the 2013 year class will be harvestable, which they have indicated is 2018. And then we suggested after the 3 year deferral period, payments would be required for 5 years. After that, the remaining loan would be forgiven. So it incentivizes businesses to remain in operation for at least 8 years. We agree that there should be a 5% or more to compensate the local lenders. Indeed, as far as the 2016, we suggested providing a mechanism for deed to extend this application period should the fishery be closed or catch and release only for the ice fishing season as well as the 2016 open water season.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I think we'll move on and try to get all the departments in. So Commissioner Bauerly, if you want to proceed with your presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the working group. If you would mind turning to the memo from the Department of Revenue. As we've been discussing, under existing law, counties do have the authority to abate property taxes for their taxpayers. This includes the ability to abate a payment that is upcoming. For example, the second half share for many folks is due in October if they haven't made their full payment in May. It also includes the ability to provide a refund of previously paid taxes. But as we have discussed at this table, that counties and other local governments have pressures upon them as well. And so the idea that they could simply be able to provide this kind of property tax relief to people without reimbursement is unlikely. And I think that one of the benefits of this working group has helped us crystallize that. We have heard from all of you that that is unworkable. And so a special session is necessary to authorize reimbursements for counties for abatements offered to impacted businesses. I want to make clear that these abatement decisions would still be handled at the local level by the county, but that there are two main ways that we could accomplish providing reimbursement. The first would be to specify eligibility factors in statute, and that is what you'll see below you in the memo. The other option would be to allow the counties to make those decisions themselves and specify a cap for a potential reimbursement for counties. I can anticipate that counties may view that kind of authority as both a blessing and a curse, if you will, because it would put the pressure directly upon them. One of the benefits of this working group is that we have stakeholders not only from the legislature, but from the local community, from the Mille Lacs Area Tourism County and Council, and from the Mille Lacs Band of Ojibwe. So we have an ability to gather information here to help craft the next step of this proposal. So were we to put the criteria into legislation, there are four factors that we would want to probably identify, we would recommend that we identify. The first would be the impact or the connection to the closing of the walleye season. And we have heard during this working group that this is not just about the closing of the walleye season. This is a long-term decline. But certainly the closing is a significant event along that path. Is a good place to start. And so the initial criteria of a connection to the closing of the walleye season, again, we could discuss whether it should be broader and some other connection to the walleye resource. For example, we could ask for a demonstration of significant economic loss. It could be establishing loss of a percentage of annual revenue. So again, reflecting if there has been changes over time. Similar with what Deed is proposing, you could look at losses in certain time frames to provide that kind of structure. Once we've established some connection to the walleye resource and the loss of it, the geographic boundary is an important question. I think there are a couple of options. Certainly, we have heard, and I think in this conversation about the Red Lake response, there were people who fell outside of those geographic boundaries, and so we wanted to consider whether all property in the geographic boundary be all three counties that surround the lake. A smaller geographic boundary would be townships surrounding Mille Lacs Lake, and I will note some plagiarism from a list that Representative Lewick gave me last week. These are the counties that he identified, so appreciate that feedback already. Certainly, it could be a slightly different set. Again, your feedback on that would be helpful. There could be some other limit. Again, we've been talking about a 15-mile from the center of lake. Again, property taxes are, you know, townships are and parcels can be identified within zip codes and other boundaries, so we think that the township might be an important way to go. We also would want to look at the classifications of property. Property taxes are focused on the classification of property, and so that can give us some good guide points as to which properties should be allowed the reimbursement for the abatement. Seasonal resort property is a classification that is within, if you look at what I've provided in 3A, I'll direct you to the sort of the structure of the rest of the memo. It provides a classification type and, where necessary, an explanation and a footnote of what that classification means, because not everyone readily has the same definition of what seasonal resort property is. It is property that is in operation not more than 250 days per year. It includes both commercial resorts and what we call ma and pa resorts, which are resorts that have a homestead on them. The next line under A provides you with a rough estimate of all of the property taxes owed to local jurisdictions by the properties in that classification within the geographic boundary. So you'll notice that in the three-county area, there's about $1.4 million in property taxes owed by those properties in the seasonal resort property classification. In the townships, there's about $276,000 in property taxes owed. And Representative Lewick, you asked me last week about the statewide property tax. Mm-hmm. For those seasonal resort properties in the 14 townships, it's about $36,000. And I apologize, I don't have the statewide number for the three-county area, but I can provide that. So as you, but as you will notice from that, those numbers, just the relationship between the local property taxes owed by seasonal resort property in the 14 townships is $276,000, and the statewide property taxes are $36,000. We had at one earlier in this working group's conversation talked about abating the statewide property taxes. That would also require special session. The department does not have authority to do that, and so those numbers could certainly be included as well. If you'll turn to page 3, if we expanded the types of property classifications that could be eligible for this reimbursed abatement, all commercial property and seasonal resort property within the geographic boundaries would be approximately over $30 million for the three counties, or 1.9 for the 14 townships. And the statewide property tax total for those townships is $463,000. We could narrow it to specific industries within those areas and within a geographic boundary. So item C provides that option. And D provides that all properties within the location, so regardless of whether they are commercial, it would include residential property, that gives you the total amount of property taxes available or that are due in those jurisdictions. So the dollar amounts are there to reflect what the potential cost to the state would be if we were to offer the reimbursements for the abatements. And so, again, we would appreciate help in determining the scope of which properties and the geographic locations. And again, I think that it's certainly beneficial to have members from around this area who have been talking to their constituents, and also members of the working group from the local community to help us answer these questions. The final question in this area, or criteria in this area, would be about time frame. Would we be talking about property taxes payable in 15, whether they've been already paid and therefore would be in a refund process, or property taxes going forward in payable 15? And we've also discussed that, particularly until we know what's happening with the winter season, looking forward to 16 may also be of benefit to these businesses. And then, as I mentioned, there is an alternative to this approach. This approach would put these definitions into statute and lay it out for counties, and then they would provide a documentation to the Department of Revenue. We would provide that reimbursement from general fund pursuant to the legislation. The other option would be to set a cap for each county and provide that the counties could make decisions about the connection to the walleye resource loss and leave it to county decisions. And then counties would certify to the Department of Revenue that they have provided this amount of abatement and they would like to be reimbursed. They generally would provide us with parcel lists so that we would know which properties were affected. And then we would provide that reimbursement. If that were the route the legislation were to go, we would look for a total cap dollar amount for each county. And counties are familiar with this process because this is a process that we use in the disaster abatement area. So were a disaster to be declared, counties would have the authority to go ahead and abate, and then they seek reimbursement from the department through providing a certification and a list of properties affected. So again, the governor is proposing that we provide reimbursement to counties for the reimbursement of property taxes abated to businesses who've been impacted by this kind of property tax relief, particularly because the October share payment is one of those bills that is coming due, would be a significant benefit to these property taxpayers. We would like input on geographic scope, on property classification scope, and some assistance with understanding the appropriate time frame. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members.
Thank you. Questions, members? Chairman Tomasoni.
Commissioner, so the October payment, you don't need legislation from us to abate the October payment, do you?
Commissioner?
Mr. Chairman and Senator Tomasoni, to abate the October payment, counties do have the ability to do that, absolutely, under existing law. Mm-hmm. We also know that from talking with counties and talking with other local officials that their budgets are set, and so they would need, if they were to provide those abatements, they would be cutting into their own budgets. They may need to pull that money from reserves, and ultimately the rest of the levy would wind up picking that up in the future years.
And we could reimburse them in the regular session if we so chose to do so, because they do have reserves and that's what they're there for. So, all right, that's...
Anything additional? Okay, I think we'll hear from... Representative Lloyd.
One of the things, and I'll just... I've had a lot of discussion with at least two of the three counties. Well, actually, all three. Sitting right here. There is a real legitimate concern for the level of staffing time that would require, for example, that population of 161 that we talked about for loans. That's a real long haul for county administration, because from down here we may not see it, but they've got full-time jobs right now. Obviously, they're ready to do whatever they can to help. But I do have a little concern that we're really asking the counties to not just run the dollars, but to put that level of administrative on their backs. I've done abatements as a county commissioner, and so this is not a simple prospect to be done at the local level. So I'll just raise that concern that if we just say counties, obviously they've got the authority, we all understand that at this table, but say just go solve the problem, that's a huge burden for something that they had nothing to do with. Say there's others here that may get an opportunity to testify that can tell you point blank how it will impact them and their staff, and simply interject picking winners and losers, because if you just assume everybody's going to get the abatement they apply for, that's not how the process works. And so now we're going to force the county boards to get down there and sort this out. I got some real reservations with that. Thank you, Mr. Chair. That's just a comment, not a question.
Commissioner Bauerly.
Thank you, Chairman Hackbarth and Representative Lewick. I appreciate it wasn't a question, but I did just want to express that one of the benefits we think of putting some of these criteria into legislation is it can take some of the pressure off of those counties, because these are difficult decisions. These are in every county there are going to be different types of landowners and different property classifications, and the department certainly would work hard to make sure that we are providing support. We certainly wouldn't, mandate a particular form, but we could certainly help counties with that. So we would certainly offer our help as well. We understand that this, we know very well from working with counties as primary customers of ours, that they are very, very busy and there's a lot of requirements on them and they have staffing issues as well. So we do appreciate that, but thank you for raising it.
Okay. Commissioner Strowman, are you ready to make a presentation for the DNR?
Mr. Chair?
I'm sorry.
This is kind of, it goes back a little bit, but it's kind of in the, I'm intrigued by Representative Erickson's idea of an enterprise zone, and I just kind of like to have her just in a couple of sentences kind of tell us what she's thinking about there.
Commissioner Erickson, response to that?
Senator, it's still a secret.
Okay. Let me know as soon as you can.
I work with my researchers, so we're putting together some ideas.
I think it's a
good
idea. I just wanted to encourage you. Yeah.
Well, it's for economic growth, so I think you can kind of figure out what we're looking at. Thank you.
Chairman Tonasoli.
So as I'm sitting here thinking about all of this, I think the number of questions that Deed has asked is part of the problem here, and how to approach what we're thinking about doing. Hearing whether or not any legislators are in favor of a special session is interesting, because I haven't heard of anybody who wants to have a special session for this. In addition, if we do have a special session and we give out short-term loans to the resorts, and then the DNR closes the walleye season for December, We've got an even bigger problem, and then how do you pay back these loans, and do the loans get paid back, and do they actually even accomplish anything? And I still haven't heard any response on reopening the walleye season, because I'm hearing all kinds of different statistics on how many fish actually have been taken, and who's counting, and how they count, and whether or not there's enough stock in the lake to keep the walleye season going. But I think before we go on to the next presentation, I think the main question we have to know here is the governor going to call a special session? And if he's not going to call a special session, we're wasting our time. And if he is going to call a special session, I'm assuming that he wants to have some agreed upon parameters that maybe this is what this group has been put together for, but whether or not we're getting anywhere on that, I'm not sure just yet. So maybe something will develop as the day goes on.
Commissioner?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. A couple of notes before I begin the walkthrough of the Department of Natural Resources handout. I will just say, despite the name tag in front of me, I'm Sarah Stroman, Assistant Commissioner with the Department of Natural Resources, sitting in today for Commissioner Landwehr. I also just want to note that distinct from the proposals you've heard from DEED and Revenue here today, the actions that I will walk through for DNR are not dependent on a special session. These are things we are moving forward with. Items that require funding could be done during a regular session. So the main focus of the DNR's efforts here, I'll just remind you, Commissioner Landwehr has talked about this, and our fisheries chief, Don Pereira, talked about this too. The main focus of our management activities is to protect the spawning population of walleyes in Lake Mille Lacs and that 2013 year class. Those really are very important things that we have going for us and that are positive in Lake Mille Lacs. And so we want to make sure that we maintain the status of that situation. The other items on this list are things that we believe we can begin implementing in addition to those. That really help us focus on the future, get ahead of the management issues that we've been experiencing in Mille Lacs, and help engage the community in some of these decisions. So I will just walk through the items on this handout, and I think most of these the commissioner mentioned at the last meeting as well. So the first one is a short-term stocking plan. And the idea here is that we would immediately begin working on a stocking plan that would allow us to collect eggs from Lake Mille Lacs, hatch them either in an existing facility or in some kind of temporary facility, and begin the stocking. Part of the goal of the stocking would be for us to be able to learn a little bit more about the lake, about hatch rates, so that we could develop a Mille Lacs specific protocol going forward. Secondly, we're looking at some new staffing, organization, and capacity at Lake Mille Lacs. One of the things we want to do is really make Mille Lacs its own project area. And so we are looking at assigning a new project leader, adding some new outreach or community liaison capacity there, as well as providing additional staff for support for the monitoring and research work that we do there. Short term, we would like to have some kind of office space on the lake. And then longer term, what we're looking at is really constructing a new facility that would function as a research facility, a hatchery space, as well as a community space, too. We could envision, I think Ms. Chapman may have mentioned this and Ms. McCoyd in their testimony last time, that there's the potential of having learning opportunities, classroom space, tourism types of interactions at this facility as well. Next, one of the items that the commissioner addressed last time and has come up in discussion in this committee is control of cormorants at Mille Lacs Lake. The DNR has committed to starting coordination with U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service on that issue. In fact, the commissioner did send a letter to the Midwest Regional Director at Fish and Wildlife Service, and we are working on a meeting to initiate those discussions. We will also need to initiate discussions with the bands on that as well. Next on the list is pursuing ice fishing options. This came up a few moments ago in the discussion. We understand the critical nature of the ice fishing season at Lake Mille Lacs. I want to be clear on that.
The timing on the decision around what happens with ice fishing is dependent on what our September net assessments tell us. And so we will be doing that netting through the month of September. We will need some time to process the data. And then the technical work group will meet in mid-October. And at that time, we will be able to make a decision about ice fishing. But it will be dependent on what that netting data tells us. Additionally, in the vein of engaging the community more in what's going on at Mille Lacs and in the DNR's decisions, we are proposing to create a new advisory committee. We have for some time had an input group. We would like to have a more formal advisory committee that has members representing the businesses, homeowners, angling interests, et cetera, and that. And so we are working to develop a charter for that group and move forward with that. We also think it's important that we help improve the transparency of the quota setting process, and we think this advisory committee may be a vehicle to do that. One of the ideas that we've had is to have a couple members from that advisory committee be able to serve as observers in those technical meetings where those quota setting decisions are made. And then finally, we think that advisory committee could also serve to generate ideas that the department may consider, to discuss ideas that may come up from the community or others, and to help provide advice to the department on a whole range of issues, some of the ones that have come up here, and there may be other issues that come up here as well. And we think that advisory committee would be a good forum in which to address those issues. And so that, Mr. Chairman, are the list of short-term action items that the department is either engaged in pursuing or will be engaged in pursuing, and again, not necessarily related to the special session discussion.
Okay, Commissioner Stroman, the last couple of meetings we talked about trying to renegotiate something with the tribes and looking at the potential of maybe reopening the season for walleyes again. At least until after Labor Day, or opening it just for Labor Day weekend, something along those lines. And I haven't heard whether that had been pursued or if that's just something that the governor and the department didn't want to do. So if that's the case, and I'm kind of getting the message that didn't happen and that's not going to happen. So if that's the case, when does this netting to judge the numbers in the lake going to take place? You said September, but is it beginning of September, mid-September? And if we're not going to allow walleye fishing on the lake the rest of this season until maybe ice fishing time, can that start earlier so that the resorts can get a feel for, find out a little earlier whether there's going to be an ice fishing season or not?
Mr. Chairman, to your first question, I think two things. One is Commissioner Landwehr did reach out to the bands. I think also as this committee asked the question in a very public way, there was response both from the bands and the governor that there was not interest in reopening the walleye fishing this year. So I think that was the response to that question. With respect to can we start the data gathering process earlier, my understanding is that September really is when we need to begin that due to temperature constraints and other issues, that it will take several weeks to gather the data, and then it takes some time to process the data as well. And so I think at this point we cannot commit to having that information any earlier than that mid-October meeting.
And Commissioner, when is that going to take place? When would you have that information specifically?
Mr. Chairman, the meeting of the technical group in October, I believe, is scheduled for October 15th and 16th. And so that's when the data would be available basically in time for that meeting.
Representative Erickson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And thank you for these ideas. I just want to let you know that there's angst about stocking the lake, as I have visited around the lake the last 2 days. There's a real urgency about bringing in outside experts so that we move away from the politicalness of the treaty management. People have asked me that that when Don Pierre or anyone from the DNR presents, that they always be truthful with the input group or the stakeholder group. So if they've learned something from GWFLC or from the bands, that the input group is made aware of this instead of finding out after the fact. That transparency is utterly important, that private meetings we know occur between GWFLC and the Minnesota DNR, and that these technical meetings are pretty much just an amen to those decisions that have been made. That doesn't set well with the people who own this lake and all lakes in Minnesota. And an annual report is needed of the spending and the revenue sources on the management of Lake Mille Lacs. Hopefully it will be based on sound biology, not on treaty. And then I want you to add a bait fish. And I know the governor learned this when he was fishing at Hunter's Point, we probably need a different policy for a while on the taking of bait from the creeks as the spawn occurs. And I noticed the governor in the Mille Lacs Messenger said that he'd never heard of this. And I know the DNR has known about this, and I know that George Nitti at Hunter's Point has talked about it numerous times, so I can't imagine that the DNR hasn't been aware of the fact that, if those bait fish aren't allowed to move into the lake, we're going to be minus some food for the fish. And then limits on number of fish versus slots, and catch and release is really up in the air. So, we have a lot to discuss, or you have a lot to discuss, but you need to share it with the people who understand and know the lake. And I think a major reform of what's been going on is needed, and some drastic changes for the sake of the people. Who not only love Mille Lacs, but fish Mille Lacs, live on Mille Lacs, come to enjoy, and all these families who over the years have, like mine, come to Mille Lacs and found enjoyment there. And Mr. Chair, as long as I have the floor, I didn't want to be so snarky to you, Senator Sexhaug. I'm sorry. I visited everybody in Mille Lacs County, at least, and I want to just remind people that Izades is back and running, and they're a world-class golf course premier. They probably have the top manager in the state in Steve Schumacher, and I am so happy to see that. They also are looking at adding some sailing, because that's a good place for sailboats to leave. Appledorns has just recently added a bar and a grill. That's a great addition, and if you've never visited Appledorns on the east side, they have a great beach. They have family activities to go out in the water, a slide and everything. Rocky Reef, they added a bar and a grill a couple of years ago. Randy's Rentals was doing a photo shoot when I was there yesterday to promote jet skiing on Lake Mille Lacs. Hunter's Point, George Nitti's giving away walleye if you catch a bass. A lot of these places have converted to RV parks over the years, and that would be a good economic tool to provide for that. Island Resort, as you know, on the way between Waukon and Isle, has gone to these permanent mobile homes, and they have a marina, and so that's been encouraging. So, we need to look at things like that. How do we enhance the development of that by providing them these resorters and entrepreneurs and innovators with new ideas so that we can build on this. There are lots of ideas. It's just that when your capital is little, you can't take advantage of this. So there's a lot of debt, like Izades is sitting on a lot of debt, but they're trying their darndest to move forward. And if we can focus on the golf and maybe the and their swimming pool is back open, and so that's a wonderful amenity. So there are things we can build on and some new ideas, which I will certainly share with you. So I apologize if I sounded a little bit high. Thank you.
Next on the list is Karen McQuaid.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. I want to point out again that we're here. We really believe that economic assistance is very, very important. But I would be remiss in not sharing some of the feedback that I have for this plan. I would be remiss in not representing the other people from our community.
And of course, we do want to have discussions in good faith with the DNR, but please let me share with you some of the thoughts. With respect to a short-term stocking plan, to us, it seems counterproductive to remove fish who would already be producing fry and continue to do that year after year to do this hatchery or the stocking plan. And perhaps there might be a way biologically to do that either with the fish that you capture in your nets in the spring or the fish that the bands capture, so that maybe we're not removing some of the fry that would already be existence. And with respect to the new DNR staff and the outreach or hatchery facility, you know, I think that it's somewhat disturbing to think that we can add more people and spend $3.5 million more dollars when we're just needing some help to survive here. And there's questionable results. And maybe some of that transparency and discussion needs to happen first. But questionable results, and this is one that I was just made aware of, in the data that Melissa Trammell gave us, Mr. Pereira said that the walleye harvest management, and I'm quoting from the presentation he gave us as a working group and also in earlier committee meetings, the allowable harvest is set at 24% of the biomass of all walleye over 14 inches, which in retrospect was likely too high. However, if I go to the numbers from Melissa Trammell that were sent to Tina Chapman, and this gives us the pounds of walleye 14 inches and longer since 1987, and the pounds of mature walleye. But let me focus on the pounds of walleye 14 inches and over. According to this data, there are 941,555 pounds of walleye in 2015 that are 14 inches and longer. My math of 24% of that number comes to 225,000 pounds, which is a far cry from the 40,000 pounds that were set as an allowable harvest. And perhaps we need to have a better understanding of that number, but this is where some of the questions come from. So this is why our area continues to say, we're not trying to destroy the fishery. We don't agree with your estimation of the health of the fishery. These kinds of numbers make us question that. And finally, as far as waiting for that tech group meeting, I would beg you to have that meeting earlier than October 15th and 16th. Even October 1st is too late. We've already re-roofed half of our rental fish houses. You know, you heard from Bill Eno, he's repairing plow trucks. We're investing in other kinds of capital equipment now. We aren't waiting until October 15th. So we're losing that much more money. It's really urgent that you do everything you can to get that information to us as absolutely soon as possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Root.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We've been talking and kind of focusing today on the short term, and I appreciate that. But I just want to make a comment to the DNR on the long term focus of this lake. And when you do put together the groups and in the long term, I think it's really important that we start, and maybe it's counterintuitive to what we're doing today, but we should start managing this lake for conservation instead of recreation. And I think if we focus on that, the recreation will come, because we've known that to happen in other lakes. And so I think the DNR is consistently pressured to manage the lake for recreation, but I think the focus and the goal should be conservation, because that's when we get the health of the lake, the health of the fishing population, that will support the recreation on the lake. So I think we need to refocus what we're doing on the lake, and I think we'll have a better success. So I would just ask you, excuse me, in the long term, if we can make that our focus and our goal versus the recreation, I think we'll have a much better success down the road.
Senator Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and Assistant Commissioner. Some of the concerns that have been expressed have been, will there be a winter walleye season? Will there be a 2016 walleye season that's not a repeat of this year or worse? My concern is I don't want to be back here next August talking to all the commissioners trying to figure out yet another financial package, because nothing's really changed in the management of the lake. I, I appreciate a couple of the proposals that you have on your report today, but Assistant Commissioner, my question is, are there any proposals on how to reduce the government's role in managing the lake?
Commissioner Stroman.
Mr. Chairman, thank you, and Senator Brown. I think our focus is to not have to be here again, and that's why primarily, as I said, our focus is on protecting the two things that are our best future for the lake, and that's the spawning population of walleyes that we have currently in the lake that is still showing strong, and that 2013 year class. And as was noted, it's going to take a couple more years before that year class recruits to the spawning population. But that's why all of the things that we're doing, the regulations we put in place, are to protect those so that we are on the trajectory to recovery and we don't have to be here again. I think part of the criticism has been, and as Mr. Pereira said, we may have been too aggressive in the past and we may not have been conservative enough. And so the goal is to be conservative here. That's why the walleye closure was implemented, so that we're not here year after year after year.
Mr. Chair, Assistant Commissioner, and I can appreciate that, and I hear from both sides, as do all of the legislators here, but maybe there's a meaning in the middle. Many of the people who live up in that area have a great distrust of the DNR and how the lake has been managed over the years, and your proposal here is to expand your role in how the lake is being managed. Mike, I'm just going back to, is there a way we can meet in the middle and find some solutions other than expanding the DNR's role in how the lake is managed?
Mr. Chair and Senator Brown, I think there are a number of options here. I think the advisory committee is one that opens up the process to members of the community that are outside the DNR. I think the purpose of the facility on the lake is not really to expand the DNR's role, but to shift our focus. We have a significant role there now, but we don't have a presence on the lake. And that does not allow us to have the relationship with the community that I think we might want, and that I think is reflected here in the discussion of the distrust. And so, again, the goal is not to expand the role of the department there, but it's to shift our focus and the relationship with the community so that we are more accessible to folks who want to come in, understand the information, get their questions answered without not being able to visibly see the DNR staff who are making those decisions and interacting with the lake. So I would say it's not an expansion, it's a change in our relationship with the lake and the community.
Representative McNamara.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I guess to the governor and his commissioners, it's clear the legislature, at least the legislature at this table, and I think everywhere, does not want us to have a special session. I will say historically, when we've had them, the governor, whether in my tenure, whether it was Governor Dayton or Governor Plenty, got consensus with leadership on the parameters. I'll just tell you, we are not going to get consensus with the legislature. I don't believe Speaker Dowd, Majority Leader Bach, can tell the governor that it will be contained. There's too much angst over this. There's too much unknown. I think the right thing is for the governor to sit down with hopefully the chairs of this group and come to a meeting of the minds. I think you're asking for good things. The questionnaire, I'm actually pretty happy with what the questionnaire, I think it could be shortened up. I think we have to do that, but whenever you make it shorter and smaller, then you get the situation where somebody fell through the cracks, like may happen. But specifically, just an example, if you think the three or four resorts on Lake Minnewaska that were totally devastated because the Department of Health made a mistake, they deserve a special session just as much as these resorts do. That's where that unfortunate death of the 14-year-old was misdiagnosed and totally put that lake upside down, unfortunately. And to the Iron Rangers and the issue there, to think they're going to come down here and just say, yeah, okay, or myself with Smead Manufacturing, closing manufacturing in Hastings. But I think the most important thing is we're a ways away from knowing the parameters of what's going on. And we will be able to react next March in a responsible way to help these people out. We'll know more then what has the ice fishing. A lot of this stuff can take place right now and should. And my understanding is, I just heard from leadership, we're going to have an early bill entry. We could be introducing a bill, whenever that is, in January or February with the parameters. Have committee meetings. Representative Hackbart, Senator Tomasoni, Senator Marty, and myself are all here. And I can speak for myself. I'm open to having committee meetings, formal committee meetings, to begin to have the discussion so we can give these folks answers. And I think that's right. But this is not a lockstep thing. We're going to go do it. And I'm sorry, Governor. I know he's on a trade mission, and I commend him for that. I want to improve that relationship, and that's the right place for him to be. And the fact that you folks are here is adequate for me, certainly. But it would not be right. My experience is this would be disastrous, and you've got key legislators here that I think have all said we're not ready for it. I get we put the pressure on DNR to ask for the fishing to be open. I respect their opinion that says it's not happening, and it's because of the relationship with the tribes. They know we want that to open, and I'm assuming they know what's right. And I think we can get answers. A couple of things. My experience with stocking, and there's a lot of politics and social questions to be answered on the stocking, but to the effectiveness, we can artificially stock fish. We put the parent fish back in the lake without their reproductive part. We take that to a hatchery, and I believe DNR would be able to put a greater percentage of successful fry back in the lake, probably to the level of 2013, immediately raise fingerlings and release them potentially in the fall. I'm assuming with markers on, like we do when we strip fish, that would color code them to the year they were marked so we could begin to work on this. I believe you should spend some money. We should have a bonding bill on the shore of the lake to do this facility. I support that idea. DNR has screwed up a lot of things in regards to this lake over the last 20 years. There's no doubt about that. And you should involve private people and open these doggone meetings up so Representative Hackbart doesn't have to work his tail off to attend the meeting to have some kind of a public representation there. We should have key legislators at those meetings to report on what's going on. Commissioner Landwehr reported at our last meeting that he's open to, I believe, having also someone from the resort community there. And we should have a sport fisherman there, and maybe one that's said that DNR's screwing up so they can hear it and know what's going on. So, Mr. Chair, it was mostly an editorial, but we got to get over this deal of coming to these meetings and five commissioners saying, well, this is how we want the special session to be, and then you've got the eight, I don't know how many is there, about 10 of us here, it's about 10 legislators, maybe 12 of us, saying it's not happening. You're not going to get 68 votes and 34 votes lockstep to do a one-day session and bang this through. It'll be mass chaos. That's my experience, and I don't know, Chairmen, you two been here longer than I have, or maybe Senator Tomasoni, we might have came in the same year. Seems like you've been here longer. They always have, seems like they're more experienced than the Senate. I hate to admit that, but I don't know what it is. I should say that. But I don't know. It just seems to me, Senator Marty, I just don't think this is happening. And these questions, we need to get answers to these questions before we can come rolling in here, think next week we're going to bang out a program. It matters if there's going to be an ice fishing season. How much is it going to be? What are we going to find in October of the population of the lake? There's a lot of stuff. Mille Lacs has stepped forward, the tribe, in a major league way. How much arm twisting can they do? We can't do much arm twisting on the Native Americans from Wisconsin, but maybe the tribe can work with them to do that. That'd be a huge thing that would... this has come a long way, sorry for keeping going. We have come a long ways to think we're sitting at this table with the people that are here, and there was talk about handshakes last week and stuff, but we got a ways to go. But for those that want immediate help in the next month or something, Mr. Chair, it's not happening. We don't know what we're up against, but I think the commitment to help them, is there. It's just we don't know. They don't know what help they need at this point. So thank you for the time to go on and on.
Representative Lewick.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And the discussion about, oh, no, we're not ready for a special session kind of reminds me of what our communities have been listened to for 18 years around Mille Lacs Lake, specifically from the fisheries management. Next month, next quarter, can't predict whether we're going to have a ice fishing season. So I'm not in the camp, at least for the economic side of this, there isn't some things we could do right now because make no mistake, we're not going to solve fix the lake issue here in the next 20 minutes. I would just go flat on record this is what we've been hearing for almost 20 years on the lake. Need more data, more information, can't quite figure it out. And I would hope that we would at least leave on the table the economic package. If you're going to wait till we break the lake totally and then come back, you won't have a lot of people to help because they'll be gone. So anyway, enough commentary on that. What I would like to mention about things on things that the Department of Natural Resources could be doing, both short-term and moderate-term here. You got parks and recreation and trails. Unfortunately, the lake is relied, for better or for worse, on walleyes and that type of thing to attract people. So we got some of the poorest ATV connectivity in state and surrounded by some of the best ATV facilities in that perimeter. So there's one right now. Would strike me that the DNR could step up and put those divisions to work on trying to fix that. And when I say ATV trails, snowmobile trails, bike trails, today we're looking at a world-class mountain bike facility at Crosby Ironton. But there's no connectivity to the other places there. So, I mean, that's going to take a while. But I realize this is a fishery issue, but there's a whole lot of other things that DNR does day to day, and I don't see a total agency approach to this. And I would just please ask that Commissioner Landauer take a look at that, because we need something much broader than that. On the stocking, short-term stocking, as I understand it, there's actually some walleyes that fry and potentially perch fry that exist right now. Now, I would assume you had other use for those. We got to get out of the short term, should we, couldn't we, might we, and just get on with it on the stocking question. Either say we're not going to do it and we'll just let Mother Nature sort this out, or let's get serious. It would just, unfortunately, we didn't start this 3 or 4 years ago when we watched this continuous, predictable decline. We have got to just stop and change the timelines on our management decisions. Wait until 15th of October, based on what we've always done, to make that decision on whether we're going to have an ice fishing season. Businesses just can't survive. So that's something that, I think you just got to figure out a different way to do it. That's a policy decision. And I don't know if the legislature in March, you're going to probably get some rudder orders from me and helpful statutory policy on how to do this if we can't figure out how to do it and shorten this business of when we're going to predict what we're going to do in 6 months. The rest of the world can't operate on, what are we going to do a couple months from now? They have to operate on a 1 to 3 to 5 year business plan, and we've got to recognize that and start managing in that manner. On the subject of an advisory committee, it needs to be totally independent and have absolute access to all the data that your folks use to make decisions. And it needs to be genuinely independent. I'm a veteran of many of the of those input group meetings as a county commissioner and as an interested citizen even before that. So we really need to change the paradigm on the whole approach on how we're managing this lake. And I look to the band. I think they've got some ideas. It's got to be a joint process. And we're talking about $3.5 million to build a facility. I haven't heard a word about the commercial capacity to hatch and raise walleyes. There's a whole industry out there that can turn on a dime, and we need to recognize that and take a look whether we need to build three, you know. I will just suggest, and I think Senator Brown hit it right on the head, we need to figure out a way to bring other folks into this on the management operation and the technical side. And $3.5 million, I can just imagine what the commercial side could do with that kind of money. If you turn them loose, they could raise almost any size of fish and put it any place you wanted in the state of Minnesota with that kind of money. So anyway, just a lot of commentary and suggestions and all in the interest of let's get on with it and let's fix the lake. But again, I'll go back on record and say, look, if we need a special session to do the things right now on the economic thing, then that makes all the sense in the world, because we've been hearing this year after year, all the reasons why we need a little more data to act. Well, we got to be careful. Nobody be left to help if we keep on. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Commissioner Franz.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think the key that for me in looking at trying to decide sort of the function of this working group is to focus on, I was not part of the discussion with the governor and the speaker and the majority leader, but I think we can surmise that there was a recognition that there's a problem, and there was at least some interest in potentially doing something in the short term. The more we talk about the long-term problems that are there, that are real, that I get, the biology and the other issues that are going on, and Representative Erickson, your points are well taken. We need to think long-term about this and a lot of other things. This is a complicated area. It's a complicated issue. But we're not going to solve all of the problems today or in a special session. That's not why the governor was wanting to call a special session. The governor wanted a special session to do an immediate, directed, targeted relief program that would help people now. We want these folks to be here next year and the year thereafter. Some of these folks are having trouble and they may not be able to make it. His four-point plan, short-term plan, was to provide low-interest or no-interest loans through the deed process, as described by Commissioner Katie Clark Sieben, and the property tax abatement and reimbursement process, as described by Commissioner Bauerly. There are a lot of comprehensive changes that Assistant Commissioner Stroman has mentioned at DNR that we can start now and continue to work on. Tourism has some ideas for the short term, but the idea is we can act now. We can decide not to act. That's easy to do. We can come up with reasons not to act. There's going to be plenty to do on March 8th about Lake Mille Lacs. There may be something about the ice fishing that's going to change in October. We don't know that yet. We can't solve every problem today. We can provide a direct, targeted relief package if you choose to do so. Our presentation here was designed. We could have developed hundreds of different scenarios. These are hard questions to ask, and every time you change the demographics of a particular proposal through deed or through the property tax abatement process, that takes effort. It takes effort by the folks at the county level. So the idea was to come here in a working group capacity and get ideas and to share ideas and to come up with some solutions that would work. Clearly, we're not, whatever we decide, if we were to have a special session and to put together a package, it won't be perfect. But it will help people, it will help businesses to continue on, to continue to have Mille Lacs be a vibrant economic community that we want for the long term, not just the short term. So I think the task here for the working group is not about fixing the lake in the long term. It's not about what's going to happen in 2016. It's about what's going to happen now in this fall. So that's what the governor's package is all about. And if you all want to participate and provide suggestions about how we design this package, we can get the numbers and we can draft the legislation and we can be ready to go.
Well, Commissioner, this is our third meeting?
Yes.
The first two meetings, I asked for specifics on what the governor's proposal was going to be. We wanted to know what the governor's proposal is. We still don't have that. We still don't have the specifics. The governor announced a month ago, I don't know when it was, that he wanted to have a special session. I'm going to call a special session, he said. And we're going to offer some economic relief for the folks around Mille Lacs Lake, the businesses that are going to be hurting because the walleye season is going to be closed. The first two meetings, we asked for specifics on the governor's proposal. We thought maybe when he said, I'm going to call a special session and we're going to offer economic relief, that he had something in mind already. Maybe he already had a plan. We wanted to know, what's the plan and when are you going to call a special session? Now, we've been asking that for ever since he said that. What is the governor's plan? And we haven't seen it. I mean, you've got a basic outline, but this committee was not put together to make that plan. We wanted to look at what the governor is offering. Working group is going to look at that plan and say, can we have a special session to get this plan done? Maybe we need to tweak this and that to make it happen. But we've not seen a plan from the governor. We haven't seen the specifics. It's the governor's administration that puts these plans together. You put bills together all the time. You put a budget together. You just finished putting the budget together to bring forward to the legislature, and we've got that all done. But you present the plan. And then we look at it, scrutinize it, change it, offer something different, and we haven't seen that. We've been asking, and we haven't seen it. So that's where we wanted to get with this working group. We didn't say, hey, we need to call a special session to solve the problem on Mille Lacs Lake because there's no fish in the lake, and what are we going to do? That was the governor that said that, not us, not the legislature. We took a step back, and Speaker Doubt and Majority Leader Box said, hold it. Let's put something together to see if we can make this work before we just willy-nilly call a special session. We had no idea when the governor said that, if he was going to call a special session the next day or the next week or what was going to happen. We had no clue. So we wanted to see, and now we've been asking over and over again, what is the governor's plan? You guys put those things together. Bring it forward. Show us what you've got. And you didn't do that. You come up with 24 questions for us. We were asking you the questions. We want to know what the administration's going to do. We didn't bring this up. The governor did. So why haven't we seen that? So I think Representative McNamara and a number of folks on this working group today have said, hey, this is more complicated than being able to call a special session and make this work right now. There's other issues throughout the state that need to be addressed. It's going to be too narrowly focused to call a special session to get the votes to pass a bill when there's other needs throughout the state. So I think that there's some things that the DNR has done. They're moving in the right direction on the cormorant issue. I wish that they would do a little bit more to the walleye season is closed. I don't buy this water temperature issue on doing some netting to figure out whether we're going to have an ice fishing season or not. We can make that decision without waiting until the middle of October. We just can't. It's got to be done. And I hope that they do. I hope that the commissioner moves in that direction. But you know what? Until the governor decides whether he's going to have a special session, whether he's going to bring something forward that we can look at and scrutinize and work on, I just don't think we can do it. I wish we could. I wish we could offer some economic relief to this area. Right in the very beginning, we wanted to know, is there something existing out there that we can do to help these folks? Apparently not. I think tourism, there are some dollars there that you can find that we can reimburse you in the next upcoming session in March that you can look for and do something in the direction of some advertising to promote the lake and other areas. that can be done, and I think you can do that, and we can reimburse tourism those dollars once regular session starts. We don't have to do it in a special session. So with that, I know there's some members that are on the list and have some other things to say, but you know what? I don't think this group needs to meet again until the governor makes a decision whether he's going to call a special session or if he has something that he wants us to look at. I think this meeting is adjourned. Thank you.